the topic of future of office and retail, reimagining commercial property. So in this discussion, we were talking about the residential real estate. Let's not talk about the commercial and retail real estate of Gujarat. So our session is moderated by Mr. Viren Mehta, Managing Director, Office Services, Gujarat Colliers. Mr. Mehta is based in Ahmedabad and he leads Colliers Office Services business to identify new business opportunities to grow its market share in the state. He has more than 23 years of experience in the real estate and banking industries, where he focused on establishing and growing new businesses, implementing end-to-end transactions, and leading operations to drive productivity and maximize revenue. A very warm welcome to Mr. Viren Mehta. And let me now also introduce our panel speakers in an alphabetical order. Our first panel member, I introduce Mr. Parth Patel, Managing Director, Kavisha Group. Parth Patel completed his engineering from the prestigious University of SEPT and further pursued MBA from the renowned Nirma University of Ahmedabad. And today he leads Kavisha Group, a privately held construction firm based in Ahmedabad, established since 1999. Second speaker, I introduce Mr. Prashant Bhatu, Managing Director, Surat for Pramag Group. Prashant Bhatu is passionate for creating unique land spaces, conceptualizing brilliant initiatives, and understanding consumer behavior, which makes him naturally a strong figure in the industry. The secret to his success is getting inspired by challenges and always thinking ahead of time. So our next panel member, let me introduce Rajesh Vaswani, Managing Director, Venus Infrastructure. A dedicated leader who knows how to get the best out of people, he has expertise in financial aspects of the business and has strong relationships with corporate, retail, and hotel brands and banking. His role involves finding and creating and developing business relationships. Under his leadership, Venus Group has aced the fine art of developing locations into landmarks. So very eminent panel member. Here we have our next eminent panel member. Let me introduce Mr. Sameer Sinha, Managing Director, Savvy Group. Mr. Sinha began his professional career after graduation in USA in 1996, and he returned to India to establish Savvy Infrastructure, a progressive construction company that believes in changing the paradigm of the construction business by adopting innovative technologies. It is with this approach that under his leadership, the company is now an ISO certified and the first construction company to have CRISIL rating in Gujarat. Our next and final member, let me introduce Mr. Swagat Vyas, Managing Director, Vishwanath Builders. Under the young and dynamic leadership of Swagat Vyas, Vishwanath Builders has delivered several successful and landmark projects in Ahmedabad with more than 4 million square feet of the construction area. Their projects include affordable and luxury residential, commercial shops, and office spaces based on thorough research, planning, and detailing. So this is our eminent panel, and let me now hand it over to our moderator, Viren Mehta, to take forward the conversation.
Thank you so very much, Sapna. Sapna, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, so Sapna, thank you very much, and I'm really excited to, you know, interact with all the eminent participants, and you know, I really would like to congratulate you also for taking this wonderful session and giving us an opportunity. Realty Plus is really doing a great job. It's not only to connect with the developer and a consultant or a client also, but you know, give a complete holistic picture when it comes to banking, financial, developer, everything. So great job, Sapna and Realty Plus. So, friends, my name is Viren Mehta, and I'll be moderating this session, and I'm working with Colliers. Just to give a brief background and introduction about the Colliers, is the first international consultant to be established in India since 1995. So it's been more than 25 years we are in India. We have almost 11 offices, and we have 18,000 employees, you know, of these professionals who are working, and experts who are serving occupier, institutor, investors, developer, and all. Now we are going to talk about real estate subject. So we all know that real estate is globally recognized, and it comprises of subsectors like housing, retail, hospitality, commercial also. This session largely we are going to talk more about the commercial aspect. So I would like to understand the viewpoint from all the eminent speakers, that what are their views about the commercial real estate sector. You know, before we actually jump into the question and answer, I also would like to, you know, talk about what is the size of a real estate. So, you know, one of the secondary reports says the size of a real estate, global real estate, is 2.5 times world GDP. So you can imagine how big the real estate size globally. However, if you talk about specific India, you know, RBI says household financial committee should, you know, shows only 5% of their average individual household wealth is in financial assets. This means only 5% of their wealth is being parked into the financial assets. Financial assets, thus includes the entire gamut of the financial institution. That includes the banking, mutual fund, equity, stock market, LIC, PPF, everything. And remaining 95%, the breakup of this remaining 95 is very, very interesting. 77%. I would repeat, 77% is in real estate, 7% in durable assets, and 11% that is in gold. So, you know, I generally always say that real estate is like an elephant. You know, elephant, we always know that elephant walk forward. Elephant walks slow, but never walk backward. So with this note, you know, I would like to start the, you know, question and answer. And my first question to Mr. Rajesh Vaswani. Sir, I would like to understand, and, you know, it is very, very important for all of us that, you know, post-pandemic, what are your views specifically on commercial real estate, that how it will recover and what are the trigger point which will help boosting the commercial real estate industry?
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Viren.
Thank you, Rajeshji.
Thank you, Realty Plus Group, for hosting us. It's a very interesting subject and very interesting times overall for the real estate industry. My view for the real estate industry is that we are real estate developers. We are not residential developers or affordable real estate developers, but we are real estate developers. So we've got everybody over here, or in general, have got various segments to for development. Sometimes some of the developers do too much of affordable. Sometimes, am I audible, everybody?
Very much, sir.
Thank you. Okay, sorry. So the cyclical thing which is there in the real estate cycle is very much eminent in last some time also. We have seen that some time back affordable was doing very, very well, and now the farmhouses, the land, the holiday destination locations are doing fantastically well. Also the luxury affordable, not affordable, but luxury segment of the residential side is doing really well, not only here, but overall entire world, it is doing phenomenally well. So that's all the news is. So cyclical thing also says that commercial right now is a little low, not little, but too much of low. That will also have a cyclical effect. Sometime later, maybe we might see too much of demand on commercial and no supply on commercial. So that's my overall view for the residential demand being high right now, commercial being low right now, but it's a cyclical thing. We are used to this. So nothing of a scare in general.
So, sir, when do you see? We understand that I think the COVID second phase is also low. People have started accepting that the third wave, probably what we were expecting, is not going to come. So are we seeing, you know, something, probably will it take 2 quarters or 3 quarters, or probably we are seeing in 1 quarter the commercial demand will pick up?
Very tough to predict, because nobody can predict when the COVID will really go away or vanish. We have started living with COVID. We have practiced that, and we have expertized that, I would say.
Sure.
To live with COVID being also there. So if this is the way forward, then it's X number of quarters. If this is not the way, then there's a Y number of quarters. So it's very difficult to predict right now.
Sure.
Time will tell us how do the businesses go forward. A lot of businesses need more space. That's what also is the news. And a lot of businesses are saying it will be permanently work from home for few people. So commercial back to full normal is difficult to say, but the demand will always keep on changing from businesses to businesses. Few sure. businesses are doing fantastically well, and few businesses are not able to do well. Sure. For example, gym industry, gymnastics, and household gyms have become mushroomingly well, and the commercial gym places are not doing well. So it's a cyclical thing. It's difficult from overall view. From one segment to another segment, it'll keep on changing. That's what my view.
very, 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 very valid point, Rajeshji. Coming back to Mr. Swagat Vyas, you know, the developer are basically facing a few pressure points. Okay, there is a liquidity was a concern, less in demand, slow in construction, and delay in delivery. You know, some point in time, there are people also having a trust deficit when it comes to a real estate part of the segment, and shortage of labor as well. What do you think, Swagatji, that, you know, the developer and the people will fix this? How will you cope up with this burning issue?
Thank you, Realty Plus, for hosting us, and hello to all the eminent speakers. So yes, within trust deficit was an issue for pre-RERA. Now, after RERA has come into the picture, many of the developers have tried to regain the lost confidence that was there. I'm talking about the grade B and grade the new developers. The grade A developers are always on a larger platform, and still they are because they were complying to the norms and the construction policies that they're following before RERA and after RERA, they're almost same. Talking about the labor shortage and the issues that were faced by the developers all around the world in real estate. Mm-hmm. Developers have tried to cope up with the shortage in ways like they've, you know, tried to hire expertise labor, or they've tried the technological advancement, more and more usage of construction practices which are efficient, fast, and which requires less manpower has been employed. In Ahmedabad, per se, we've seen things like basic things like, you know, when you're cutting a brick wall to lay the plumbing pipes, people using machines now, and rather than they were the laborers were, you know, putting with the hammer and needle to throw out the brick wall. So there are small things all in all in the industry that have changed, and they are going to be changed, on the verge of being changed, and that is positive all over, because we've in terms of construction, we have tried to move towards the Western culture. We've tried to move towards building big and building fast. Okay. I've seen in most of the offices or show houses that developers build, they've tried to use precast technologies, prefabricated structures, the precast walls. All those things were a little bit alien to Ahmedabad, and now people have frequently started using it in show houses and, let's say, buildings which are you know, not for a long term view. So all these things are gradually developing, and hopefully we'll try to cope up with all the pressure points the developers is facing, including the liquidity crunch. They have tried to scale down on the sizes of projects. They've tried to, you know, scale down on the inventory. They've tried to, you know, somehow push the marketing costs and complete the pending inventory first and then go ahead with another one. So yes, all those points are there, and developers all around the world, not only in Ahmedabad, are trying to cope up with the challenges, and hopefully the pressure points will be mellowed down in two or three coming quarters. So that's my overview.
Yeah, fantastic view, Swagat. You spoke a couple of things. One is construction also, one is on a liquidity aspects also. And you talked about the precasting work and all, which is really fantastic, because that will definitely give a quality much higher. I would like to understand, you mentioned about the liquidity. Liquidity issue is mainly because of the banking or financial institutions are you know, quite rigid in terms of providing finance, or probably it is less in demand. Because of that, the sale is less and the cash flow generation is a problem. What is the major issue when it comes to liquidity issue you are facing? Is a customer who is not buying, that's the reason we are not able to sell and generate a cash flow, or a banking or financial institution where you are not able to land? Your personal view on this?
So, Viren, what happens is that banks and the lending institutes have a risk weightage towards real estate of 150%. So, they have these policies of defining the weightage according to sectors. And they define the real estate sector, which is construction finance first. I'm not talking about the home loan part.
Sure.
They've defined it, it as a risk weightage of 150%. So whatever X amount of inventory or X amount of finance you're trying to gain from the bank, So the normal loans of the bank apply, and plus they factor in more 50%, reduce the 50% LTV more.
Sure.
So, and in end, what happens is in real estate, the land prices, when a developer is after procuring all the approvals and regulations and plan passing procedures and everything in place, when he's trying to lift off a project, he's only getting essentially 25 to 30% of the land value that he has already pushed in, the capital that he's pushed in.
Sure.
Towards finance. So what happens now is that in this 25 to 30% of the amount, he can only construct up to the plinth level of the project. What happens essentially is being that in a project, construction project, on and on, I'm talking about the thumb rule, when developer reaches a plinth level, he consumes already 30% of the construction cost.
Okay, sure.
So let's say if a project construction cost is costing you 100 rupees, when he's reaching the plinth level, when he's doing the foundations and then the basement and then the plinth work, he's essentially consuming 25 to 30% of the construction cost of the whole project, which is huge. And sure. That is also in the term of, let's say, 6 to 7 months. Because then there are diaphragm wall works, which has to be done very prior stage for excavation, which is a very capital intensive thing altogether. Then there is foundation, then there is raft, and then there are basement, which is covering the whole plot area. And so the construction area all in all is pretty much huge in the first 6 months.
Sure.
Then what happens after the building tops out, the construction area reduces because the buildings have the projects that are there now have a good amount of margin space and everything. So essentially the plinth area reduces to 40% of the basement level.
Sure.
Then the construction cost and everything is on a slower scale. So this is where the liquidity crunch is faced, stopgap funding that we term nowadays.
Sure.
Is that when a developer is starting the construction project, that is the hardest time for him in terms of liquidity.
Mm-hmm.
So what essentially developers now here in regional markets are doing is that they push sales in the first months of launching. They gain bookings in terms of, let's say, down payment plans or let's say front-loaded payment plans, which are attractive to the clients also, investors also. So it's all in all a win-win situation for both of the end users and the developers also, because end users are getting a priority on the location preference. They're getting a good payment plan if the payments are front-loaded and everything. So essentially, developer tries to nullify this liquidity crunch in some of the other way of selling the inventories on a front-loaded payment plan.
Sure.
So that is how he copes up with the same. And talking about the later part that you addressed, that in terms of sales velocity, or let's say in terms of cash flows, or in terms of the velocity of booking that is taking place.
Yeah.
Demand. So they're all over the demand and everything depends on sector to sector, depends on the micro market that the developers is working in. But yeah, that has not been addressed pretty much after COVID. And it's on the progress. It's on the progress of getting addressed in the next few quarters. But there are things that developers are pushing hard to do. They're trying to increase the marketing budget. They're trying to reach the customers to digital things and everywhere.
Sure.
Show houses are being constructed to, give clarity to the customers in terms of floor to ceiling height and in terms of specifications the developer is providing in the apartment which is actually being built.
Sure.
So the graded developers per se are trying to address the customers' demands and needs very particularly by constructing good sample houses, by showing in the furniture plans and everything to pick up the first end of the demand towards their side.
Sure. Thank you, Swagat. My next question is for Parth Patel. Parth, now work from home becoming a new normal. And, after this, do you see that the preference of the buyer, has changed in terms of when it comes to residential, also when it comes to commercial, because, people would always think that, if they'll have to operate from home or, office, if that is an office, then probably a social distance. And so what are your analysis for this? And have you as a developer change your inventory level?
Yes, thank you, Viren. Viren, nowadays working from home is a trend. But yeah. what I feel like there are several businesses, different type of businesses, different type of services. So people are working with. So there are different demands. One can work with an IT company working at home. But if I see the same person is a designer, that he might not work at home all the days. He might go to the office. So that kind of businesses will have to be in the office. People have to meet, people have to have some kind of working environment. So that can differentiate the choices of a buyer. But I would say like in this pandemic time, people have concentrated on the first of their residential property.
Okay.
So now they feel that the home is the only thing which is very important to family and them. So now they are also upgrading.
And they are buying the house, that is right. My only concern is that they have changed their demand in terms of, you know, earlier they were looking for 2 BHK, 3 BHK. Now they are, are they asking that I need a study room, I need a, you know, a work from home, a separate kind of 2.5 BHK kind of, which can be converted into this. Do you see that demand?
Their basic demand is one room actually.
Okay.
All are demanding that. So what I feel right now, in the last year, we have seen the tremendous demand in residential properties. So like people who are also staying in city area, now they are coming on the outskirts area. They feel that there should be more relief in that area. Now people are coming up with a working from home room extra from the builders. So they are giving 8x10 room, a 10x10 feet room for the working from their home.
So you're saying and people do not mind going bit outside, but they prefer a bigger room wherein they can accommodate their work from home requirement as well.
Yeah, both can be done. It varies from customer person to person. Sure. But if I talk about Ahmedabad, then people are targeting for working home extra room for their home only. And not just for working from home room, they need some extra space for each and every person. Now they are upgrading their home. And if I'm talking about the commercial space, now if I talk about the designing services and the other services where people have to actually go to the office and work, now I feel like working station for the safe distance of 6 feet, the working station will be converted into cubicle and cubicle will be converted into cabin.
Okay.
You might be having some extra space for customer, for your clients to come in, or even if I go to my architect office, so in a whole crowded building. So first I will see, I will tell my architect, like, do you have any extra room where I can sit and feel safe?
I agree.
There will be some extra that kind of room. And if there is an IT company, so the situation will be reversed. They might be having the whole kind of setup, extra room, which they can provide all the office workers who work from home. So that kind of setup also needs an extra electric room or something like that.
Sure. So the segment to segment, the industry to industry, the requirement is there.
And if I talk about myself, like, we have reduced commercial space right now. We have largely focused in residential space only. And for this kind of scenario, we have covered from 1125 square feet to 5100 square feet.
Okay, houses. Fantastic. Okay, so this probably a bit surge in the square feet that people are using it for residential, but use it for a official and study purpose also. That's the fantastic input part. Prashantji, I would like to understand from you and, you know, that real estate industry, you know, it's been always, you know, having seen tough time from last 4-5 years, starting from demonetization to RERA to GST. And lastly, we also saw the LNFS crisis wherein, you know, NBFC and people have stopped literally, you know, funding also, and the developer and all, you know, the industry as a whole actually had very lull period. Do you see that a developer will see consolidation? And, you know, if that is the case, I would also like to understand that how the small and medium size developer will cope up with this issue. Sir, you are on mute. Prashant.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, Prashant. Loud and clear. Thank you.
So, thank you, Viren. First of all, I'd like to congratulate and wish happy 17th year to Realty Plus, and I really appreciate them choosing me in this panel, and let me represent my views on the discussion.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Prashant, your views.
So, like, we've been in the industry since last 3 decades, and it's more than a decade for myself that I am in this business. And what I've learned so far in the business and life is that, like, changes and challenges is an ongoing thing.
Mm-hmm.
And one has to overcome and evolve from these changes and challenges. So our company's philosophy has always been like, accept and adapt the changes and challenges as quickly as possible. Talking about all the issues that you mentioned, like RERA, GST, ILLFS crisis, and now the COVID scenario. See, I believe like all these issues, they're not a bad thing, but probably the way they have been introduced and politically debated, it created a scary scenario and a lot of confusion in consumer as well as developers' mind. And hence, it gave a pause to the decision-making process, and sales and cash flow cycle was disturbed for a while. As we accepted and adapted the changes, the work started with the new equation, and we saw good changes and new opportunities in the market.
Sure. So you pointed very well that, you know, real estate developer are basically a tough people, and, you know, they are quite resilient when it comes to, you know, handling all the difficulties. Samirji, I have a one interesting and, you know, very close to, you know, me, I personally would like to understand this, that because, you know, you are actually consulting also when it comes to a green building. Okay. So, you know, it's very interesting for all of us, and, you know, specifically for the audience as well. And we all know that you are advising and giving consultancy to the developer, and not only to the developer and other people, but also to government as well when it comes to a green building. I would like to understand, sir, what is a green building? We call people that, is that green? It literally looks like a green, and you see the plantation and all. And, you know, that's what, you know, when I generally go and meet people generally, you know, keep on asking. I said, no, I am aware, but let me, you know, have this specific from the expert only. But more importantly, I would also like to understand that what is the difference of a normal building and a green building, and how green building actually help in terms of boosting the commercial real estate and entire the entire real estate or the environment as well. Samirji.
So thank you, Viren. That's a very large question for me to answer, and give me some time to do that, but I'll try and do my best to answer that. First of all, before I begin, let me express my compliments to the Realty Plus on completing 17 years, and not only for being a leading magazine, but also being a thought leader in the industry. So compliments to them for doing a great job. Also, thanks making me a part of this panel. Glad to be here with my friend Rajesh Vaswani and with the young brigade of the construction industry. So really, it makes me feel young to be part of this panel. So before I get to the green building, let me express my views on what I feel will be the impact of this pandemic on our industry, or actually on our cities. And I feel the impact is going to be 4 specific areas. The impact is going to be on technology, in health, in sustainability, and in open spaces. These are the 4 major areas which will get impacted by this pandemic. Mm-hmm. Technology is going to be a big role that that people will have to adopt. Everything that will have a digital twin that can be done digitally will be done digitally. There are already trends. They were existing in the market before even the pandemic happened. But specifically what a pandemic does always is it kind of manifests the trend and magnifies it and makes it faster. So Zoom existed before the pandemic, but look at what happened to Zoom and look at what we are doing right now. The valuation of Zoom, there were only 40,000 users on Zoom just about 2 years ago.
Yeah.
In 2 years today, the valuation of Zoom is $100 billion, twice the valuation of all the airlines in the US put together. I mean, imagine the impact that has been created just by this pandemic. And similar kind of impacts will be created on cities also. Every city worth its salt in the world, in the human history, has transformed after a major pandemic. The entire modern sanitation system that you see in London happened because of the cholera pandemic. The entire Central Park that was created was happened because the pandemic in the 1830s in New York, when the entire population migrated north of the Hudson River, and then the entire the city had to come back and redevelop that area. And they built Central Park, which is so future-proof that it even suffices for the lungs for the New York City even today. And similarly, cities will have to reinvent themselves. And these four areas will impact them. The GDP of the world happens in cities. Innovations happen in cities. They happen in commercial and retail and office spaces. They do not happen at home. They do not happen in rural areas. That is where the world functions from. So I don't think the future of our city is going to be 2 meter distancing. I don't think working from home can be the future of our city. So commercial spaces will have to happen. Retail will have to happen, but we will have to reinvent a lot of that. I think the retail, the way retail will happen, will have a lot more open spaces than it has had before. There will be a lot more surveillance, a lot more monitoring, a lot more technology. Every space that will be built will be more sustainable. I think what Shan has done, for example, in Ahmedabad with the retail spaces is fantastic. And that was actually done before pandemic, but look how beautifully it is being adapted post-pandemic, where there's enough open spaces, people can sit around, there can be enough distancing, and the infrastructure is perfect. So I think those are the kind of things that will happen. Unfortunately for the future generation, I think the young people on this panel will agree with me that the entire trend is now moving from global to global. The young generation is not interested in ownership. They are interested in experiences. There is shared mobility. This entire idea of a 15-minute city where you can walk to work is becoming extremely popular. There's a trend to walk and bike so there's a difference between density and overcrowded. I think what has happened is we have gone to overcrowded cities. We need to have dense cities which are more sustainable, which are more usable, which are more. So I think the entire post-pandemic cities will have to become more beautiful. They'll have to be more desirable. More opportunities have to be created. It has to be safer, quieter, and more fun. And that is exactly what green building does. And that is exactly what sustainable development is all about. So a green building essentially is a building which has a better indoor environment, has a better life cycle cost. It is lower than the regular building. It uses sustainable materials. It provides a better indoor air quality, higher efficiency, lower incidence of disease. There are systems in place which will make the building a better environment. So when you leave, and this is based on studies that we have done ourselves in Ahmedabad, is the number of incidence of diseases in a green building is much lower than a regular building. The productivity of a person in a green building is much higher than in a regular building. He goes back home much happier and much more energized than he goes after a 10-day workspace in a regular building. The utility, electricity or air conditioning cost in a green building is 30% lower than a regular building. So Viren, so stop me when you want to, because I can go on and on about
it. I would like to just, understand that how many, when it comes to green building, how many number of building, don't name the building, but how many number of the building you see actually they are called a real green building?
So there's a very standard, it is not a matter of conjecture anymore. There is a certification process. You will see every building that Shivalik is doing, for example, carries the shield of a green building, IGBC shield on the hoardings. There are so many of my young friends who are on the panel who are already doing green buildings. So it is not a matter of it is a standard certification process. You can go for that. You can use the shield on the building. It says it is a green building. And then there are data to prove it.
But how many? We know that they have certification.
You want to know how many green buildings in Ahmedabad?
Just roughly number, because
I think the number in Gujarat is about 150.
150. Okay.
Yeah. And about, I think there are about another 100 or so which are under certification.
Okay.
As we speak.
Sure. Very, very valuable.
Which is incredible, considering that 4 years ago or 5 years ago, there were only 5.
Significant rise. That's great. And it's good that, people like you who are giving advice to other developer and a government actually, making things very clear for the society. And obviously,
let me just add, Viren, that sustainability is not an option anymore. You will have to commit to it. If you follow the EIA, if you follow GDCR, you're already doing a gold certified green building. It's just not getting a certification for it.
Fantastic, fantastic. Thank you, Prashant. I would definitely have a separate session on this. Would like to see you in person and, you know, have a long discussion. Okay, my next question is for Prashant ji. Sir, you know, we all are talking about, you know, the shortage when it comes to manpower and, you know, all this. So will it really affecting because of COVID and all other issues put together, is it increasing our construction costs? If that is the case, because that construction cost again will lead to a, you know, a rise in a finished product. So what are your take on this?
So the straight answer would be yes, the construction costs are increasing, and it's more affecting the affordable segment, because where we try to keep our pricing as low as possible, our construction cost. But it's not only the construction cost that is going up. Like with the time, we have to keep ourselves updated and upgraded. So like we are involving more technologies and some R&Ds. So like those costs which were like which were almost zero like a few years back. So this new cost plus the I would say like GST has added to some of our costing factors. So yes, the costs are going high and it's affecting the affordable segment more than other segments where there are more margins.
You are absolutely right, Prashantji, because I was recently reviewing the June report, July report rather, of CREDAI, wherein out of 13,000 developers who have registered and 4,800 roughly developers who have answered the questions, 92% developers are saying because of this pandemic and all, that there is a delay in construction and the cost of construction has increased. So 92% developers are agreeing what you are saying. So that's really a challenge. And for the developer to justify the cost, because always customer would like to buy a property at a competitive rate, and a developer again keep on fighting to deliver a product which is very economically, but you know, it is quite unfortunate that, you know, this all on things are leading to a cost rise. My next question is for Parth, and this is though we are talking about commercial, but I would like to highlight specifically on retail subject, sir. Retail is very, very interesting and lucrative when it comes to an investor on, you know, a separate business line. This is the industry got hit very hard. How do you see that retail business will come back in action? You know, when we talk about retail, we all know that, you know, either it's a shop or either it's a restaurant or it's a mall, you know, everything. What are your take? This is the industry got hit very hard.
Yes, we're in. It's exactly right. The retail industry is very hit very hard. But if you talk about 6 months back, it was badly hit. But if we talk about right now, so many businesses have, like high street shopping, that has come to the normal level, at least 70% of sales, which was previous before the pandemic. Mm-hmm. Malls are still facing the issues. Sure. But and the main thing for the malls is that cinema has not opened yet. Because the highest footfall into the mall is due to the cinema. And just few days back, I was talking to some leasing agent, mm-hmm. one of the reputed agent in Ahmedabad. Sure. He was saying that the companies, the branded companies which are having showroom in all the areas, now they are doing good in smaller areas, like the outer areas, which are smaller towns.
Sure.
If you talk about Ahmedabad, Surat, and all the metro, mega cities, The still the sales is around 50, 60, 70%. But the small towns are doing very good. They are around 80 to 90%. Some are also reached 100%.
Okay. Do you see any structured transactions is shaping the place? Because we have come across with the many instances, because we manage a large developer also, and we work with the brand and, you know, clients also. Generally, what my take, and, you know, we have understood from overall, is that they come up and say that, you know, let's get into a revenue share model then rather than getting into a fixed rental. Do you see more that is happening?
Yes, actually, it was also before the pandemic. But I would say, like, revenue sharing is the best thing. Like, when the land land prices are gone up high, so now mm-hmm. we go for JV. So there is the option. So for this also, revenue sharing is the best option. So where he is also at ease, the buyer is also at ease, and the person who is lending the property. And mm-hmm. right now we do have properties like this.
Okay.
We have leased to some brands, and we have both options. Like whichever is the highest we get. If we get the higher share, then we get that. Otherwise, we get the lowest square foot rate.
Great, great. So that's your very valid point that, you know, whatever the yield which makes you higher, you would opt for that rather revenue sharing or the minimum rental. That's the wise way to, you know, compensate the cost. With this, Rajeshji, I would like to ask you, you know, though you are managing all assets class, I'm well aware about your all the projects you manage, commercial, you residential also, mid-level, luxury, all kind of you know, segment you are coming up with, which is your you know, the area of subject which is excites you and you see that that has a high growth potential, that is one. Secondly, which are the segment probably, you know, you know, you would like to wish to get into? Hello?
Hello, ek event chale se.
Okay. So, Rajeshji, you know, I'm talking about few segments like student housing, co-living, co-working, senior citizen, you know, like data center. You know, I would like you to, you know, speak up on this, that which is the segment, you know, excites you and you see that, you know, the growth is taking place in this particular segment.
See, as a real estate developer, what excites me is the growth or the opportunity. So wherever the growth or the opportunity lies, that will always excite not only me, but all the panelists over here.
Sure.
So it's a generalized answer. I would not.
Jahan paisa hai, wahan pe jao. Is that the okay?
But at the same time, I'd like to go to one by one sector also.
Sure.
What is happening is these are the new areas that have been declared or envisaged by everybody. That student housing is a new thing, which is a lacking in general all over the country, which has been doing well in some of the pockets. Mm-hmm. Co-living, co-working, home for senior citizens, data centers. Apart from this, I would also say the logistics, the warehousing, which was also unorganized, is also exciting in the new segment,
mm-hmm.
sector. All these sectors, all the segments would be area-specific, location-specific. Mm-hmm. For example, student housing can do wonders in the city like Kota, in a city like Pune, but in Ahmedabad, it can do very well near to the universities only. It cannot be generalized for the entire city of Ahmedabad or the Gujarat.
Sure.
Student housing can do well. It cannot do well at everywhere. That is the one point. Co-living, yes. Co-living can do well anywhere where the IT is doing good or the banking is doing good or commercial segment is doing good. So that also is a very dynamic answer to that. In Ahmedabad, I would say any place near GIFT City, unless the housing supply comes in. There are a lot of employment already generated at GIFT City.
Sure.
And going on, it will also improve. I don't see any major housing coming in there. So anything near to GIFT City would do very well if it's a co-living space being generated there. Co-working, yes, co-working is an exciting thing because it's a cost-saving thing for a lot of new startups and mid-segments and a lot of large corporates also, because it gives a lot of dynamism to increase or decrease the space overnight. So co-working will be always there. It is a new segment. It excites everybody, not only me, but yes, it excites me as well. So that's for the co-working. Home for senior citizens, it can do well. It is not doing that great, according to me, except for one or two small pockets all over the country. To support that, I would urge the government of India to support it by any means, by policy guidelines or banking regulation or RBI push or something like that. Then the senior citizens or anything for senior citizens should be done. It's a need of the hour. So if that is being pushed right now, the home loans for senior citizens is a big, big, big challenge. So how does that work? And life expectancy is improving. So according to that, the financial model still is yet to evolve and yet to erupt, I would say that. Data center, yes, it's doing very well in, again, a small pockets. In NCR, it is doing well. In small pockets of Mumbai or MMR is doing good. Bangalore, Chennai are doing good. We are yet to see the eruption of data centers over here. I would again repeat logistics and warehousing, which has been missing overall in the entire country. That's a new segment wherein it will change the dynamism of the traditional working and the traditional way that logistics and warehousing has been doing since long in a very traditional way. There's a lot of demand from large MNCs like Amazon, these Flipkarts, Walmart. They want organized warehousing, and the supply of warehousing has been very, very limited. And the infrastructure around warehousing and logistics is very, very poor. So wherever logistics and warehousing is developing is only developing on the highways. So any land two lots behind the highways is not able to generate demand for that location, because the road infrastructure, the drainage, the water logging is a big, big issue all over the country. So all the lands in the logistic locations on the highways are on demand because of easy access, the drainage, all the issues are being solved easily. So that is a new area which is exciting and which can generate a lot of revenues all over the industry.
Yeah, well defined, Rajesh ji, that student housing, in particular segment, co-living, complement when if it is opened in a particular segment, data center and warehousing, very, very, very well defined. I'm sure there is a great to, learn from this. My next question is for Mr. Prashant. Private equity players, sovereign funds, these people are also investing into real estate. What are your thoughts when it comes to real estate, that which segment they would prefer, and how this funding will help boosting the overall real estate? Prashant ji, Apo, you are on mute.
So there are many private equity funds, and they exist many years now in India. And like any other company, like all these companies have their set goals and criteria based on the size of the funding, the location, certain type of development standards, certain asset class.
Mm-hmm.
And so far, like I believe the investment so far has been more towards the commercial spaces, but for future, like also, like I would like to add, like a major of the investment has been made in the tier one and metro cities. I'm not sure about like how their investment so far has performed, but like I would definitely suggest to explore the tier two, three cities.
Sure.
And personally, I think there is a lot of scope in like rental housing model with like early stage funding involved, and
sure,
a proper facility management and a good developer tie-up. Like this could do really well for future. And also, as Mr. Vaswani mentioned, there is a huge potential in warehousing space as well. So future, maybe we will see some diversion in this.
No, you are absolutely right, because I was just reading one of the article, because you mentioned about this PE player, largely they are investing into metro cities and tier one cities. They are having still spectacle when it comes to investing money into the tier two cities. And second, you mentioned about that people, they prefer investing in asset which is income generating asset, so that is the key area generally. We've been working with all Blackstone and Brookfield and Indospace and all the, their first definitely a criteria to look at asset which is income generating. So very well answered that, first preference is the metro, and then
the ticket size matters to them. Sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
So their funding size, they wouldn't want to invest a small chunk and set up a management team for something smaller.
Sure. So Abhijit, again coming back to, I was just in reference to the point which Rajesh ji talking about industrial business line, I would like to take your view also, that industrial business, like Ahmedabad is typically, you know, known as an industrial destination, unlike Bangalore or Pune or Hyderabad, people talk about that's an IT destination. So, we are seeing that, warehousing demand going up? Will this warehousing has an impact on our retail business or hotel or aviation business? Because, you know, people have moved from physical buying to online buying or so. And this has also helped, increasing our demand or per se the, you know, industrial business when it comes to warehousing business or so. What are your take on this?
Yes, as Rajesh ji mentioned very correctly, the industrial warehousing is a sector-specific thing where even now the GDCR, current GDCR has dedicated zones where it has defined industrial zone for spaces. Sure. In Ahmedabad, the nearest places. But addressing to your concern on the whether the industrial housing demand or industrial warehousing will reduce the retail demands or not, but I'm more on a negative side that I don't think so, because the reason being that increment in industrial warehousing demand would not politically affect brick and mortar stores that are currently sure. running. Let's say stores like Apple, or let's say stores like Croma or Max, or brands like Levi's, or whatever the electronic appliances, and across various segments, those sure. brands have more essentially warehousing centers centrally located at some places at a distance. But they, in order to cater to the retail people, in order to cater to the mass, they have to be there on the high street. They have to be there on the main streets. They have to be there in the emerging micro markets, like Parth just mentioned that FMCG brands and leasing spaces, like even brick and mortar small stores like Hemmore and the bakery stores and all such things. They have to be there on the main street. They have to be present there in order to have the visibility, in order to have the capture of the market. So yes, I feel that it won't have any adverse impact on the retail per se part of the demand.
No, you're true at some point in time, because people would love to go and touch and feel, and brick and mortar model. Right. You still talked about that people would like to go visit. In fact, there was a report we talk about that the e-commerce business captures only 8% of the entire business. So still. There is a huge leg room to grow, and people will definitely would like to go touch, feel, and take that experience. That experience can't be taken away by e-commerce business.
So, and I think more essentially, Viren, that it's on the reverse side more, mm-hmm. because let's say stores like Pepperfry, who are only present online and who are only present in, they have that warehousing processes house in where they have manufacturing furniture and such things. They've mm-hmm. essentially come to the retail part of it. They've come on places where clients can visit their stores, look at the product.
Yeah, yeah. Connect so it. Off online to they have become offline.
Yes,
yes. Correct. I've seen. Yeah, they are getting into a store in the city.
Correct. Yes,
in fact, Amazon also, they have a two model. One is, in the city and outside the city model, wherein, they can service. So, yeah, very, very, very well taken. Samiji, I would like to understand when you're talking about commercial business. Okay. Gujarat basically and Ahmedabad per se commercial business, either it's leasing or either it's a strata sale, is compared to other cities is still less. I need to understand that, because Gujarat and Ahmedabad per se, we have a gift, we have Dholera, we have Sabarmati, all these things. So why still the consumption is still less when it comes to other tier one or tier two city like Bangalore, Pune, Hyderabad? Tier one, definitely metro, I can't talk about. Do you think, will this help? Or if not, then probably what government and developer, we should do it?
Yeah. So Viren, I think so. We have to understand, first of all, we have to accept that we have missed the IT bus. And we should not even chase that bus anymore. So okay. Gujarat is not in the IT race at all. But fortunately, I think the vision was correct when the government invested in Gift City. Sure. And it took a little while, but it has really gained critical mass now. Mm-hmm. And what is happening in Gift City, and we've been there now in Gift City for the last almost 5-6 years.
Yeah.
And it's phenomenal, the kind of development that is happening there. But the reason for that is mainly what is in place already in existence in GIFT City. The infrastructure is world class. The policy is better than any other city in India. Sure. The policy advocacy is perfect. The collaboration with business is great. The team that is there is so progressive and so constructive. You don't have to worry about water. You don't have to worry about drainage. We don't have to worry about electricity. You don't have to worry about approvals. It's a single window. It's a dream come true for a developer. Which are exactly the Rajesh and others were talking about is sure. We are in a world where we are a development-led infrastructure kind of scenario in India. Whereas GIFT City for the first time is a city which is infrastructure-led development. There is infrastructure in place, you come in and it's plug and play. Sure. So that first of all makes life much easier. Secondly, I think cities like GIFT City or Dholera, which might take a few more years to come in, but these will provide the ideal walk to work 15-minute city concept, which really all greenfield projects in India of that scale should be. We should be able to create, we cannot transform existing cities, but at least the new cities that are coming up should be truly green, sustainable, smart cities, which are a pleasure to work in, which are a pleasure to live in. So sure. Housing should come up around it. There should be enough public transportation available. So those are the kind of things that are going to happen. GIFT City, incidentally, is the first platinum-rated green city in India. Sure. And many more of these need to come up. But kudos to the government for having this vision and for actually biting that bullet and putting the money where the mouth is and doing this. And now that you see that the fruit is there, now it is probably going to develop. I like to think that it will be the father of BKC.
Sure. I strongly believe because when I also, in 4 years, when we represent and when I head Gujarat and I go to other cities, I talk about that. Somebody said, what is there in Gujarat? I said, we have a GIFT City. And I would like to congratulate you and the entire SEBI team for, again, investing 1,000 crore, 11 lakh square feet you already developed. You are again going to develop 11 lakh square feet. And that's the reason I chose this particular question that, let me understand from Sameer that, GIFT is a commercial city and, still we are not meeting and, reaching to the level of, Pune, Hyderabad or, Bangalore is too far. But Pune consumption is almost 4 to 5 million while in Ahmedabad consumption is just 1 million square feet leasing market. You mentioned about that we should definitely forget that Ahmedabad is not an IT nation. It's well taken. But do I understand with this that if there is no IT, then there is we can't beat other cities. Is that,
I understand what you're saying, but I don't think we are in a race. Why should we compete? Why can't we create an ecosystem? For example, GIFT like is a perfect example for it started off as a financial ecosystem. Uh-huh. That is what is missing in Bombay, which the real estate price in Bombay could not afford and which is a perfect solution for that. But now it is a multi-purpose SEZ. There are multiple industries that can come into the GIFT City SEZ. Similarly, mm-hmm. Dholera can be a multi-purpose industrial SEZ. And those mm-hmm. are the kind of incentives which will create. But it takes a little while to do that. There are a certain few lifestyle issues which we still need to tackle in Gujarat. Which hopefully
I could gauge what you want right. to say out of
so,
this.
but fortunately, that is a much more critical aspect for IT than uh-huh. for non-IT industries. So I think that's why we should not chase IT. I think we should focus on the other areas.
Rajesh ji, what are your views? Because, you are the developer. Ahmedabad, I would say, 50% kind of infrastructure you have come up with. Vaswani Group is the great in all the aspects. Quality lelo, brand lelo, credibility, transparency. So what are your views? Because, recently, you have completed your Stratton project and you are also coming up with the other few more projects. Why is that? Because when I represent Gujarat, I always think of that, I should beat Pune, Hyderabad. So how we can, take this, just in line of the discussion, what Sameer was mentioning estate commerce.
Thank you for putting so nice words about me and the company. As nicely said by Sameer, we have already missed IT and we should not be chasing IT. So where are we? That's a big question. So we should be nowhere. We should be, only 20% of Pune's economy or Bangalore's economy, I would say maybe 10%. But we are not there. We are at par with Pune economy when it comes Agreed. To GDP. So where is this GDP coming from? We should be focusing on that. So according to me, it's a very entrepreneur-driven city. So we should not be losing that as our USP. It's entrepreneurship and industrial-led development. So the GDP is coming from there. So we should be chasing that. We should not be chasing IT at all. So whatever is there on the plate, we should be eating that. We should not be chasing what is not there. The lifestyle thing that Sameer told us, we know that's an issue since long. But we enjoy our life. We enjoy our social circles. We don't enjoy Bombay life at all. If the Sameer is given an option to go and live Bombay, he would say, no, boss, I'm here, happy. Am I wrong? No.
True, absolutely right, sir.
So whatever we have, we should be enjoying that.
I'm with you.
Love whatever we have. All the panelists, enjoyed talking with everyone. Yeah, please.
Sure. So, next question is for Swagaji. You know, it's specifically for Ahmedabad city, I would like to understand. The city is growing towards, west part. Ahmedabad, we all know, it is a split because of this river, east and west. So, Ahmedabad is growing towards west. Earlier, it was CG Road, then Ashram Road, then Ambawadi, Prahlad Nagar, then SG Road, and then subsequently, it is growing towards this. So, why the city is growing towards west? Per se, and then secondly, now the government is also pulling the city, people back to the city, when it comes to Sabarmati, the big project, they've invested almost 1500 crore in the reclaimed land and, 500 acre of a land, they would like to commercialize and all. What are your thought process? Like, the city is growing west, government is pulling back to the center as well. Why it is growing west?
So yes, Viren, Ahmedabad necessarily has a ring sort of topography. Also, the layout and the all of planning of the city is radial in nature. It has circular rings. The first was 120 feet ring road. Then there's 136 feet. Then there is a ring, actual ring road, just 200 feet. And the other one coming up is 300 feet, which will connect Ahmedabad and the southern part of Gandhinagar. So essentially, the whole structure of the city has been radial in nature. So what happens is that when I also see there is a shift in population shift from the eastern part of the city to the western part. So in our apartments, we have people coming from eastern parts of the city, Maninagar, Ghodasar, and all the other areas there. And there has been a consistent change towards it. Talking about the Sabarmati development, I feel that it is there and it is trying to attract people from the east towards Sabarmati rather than the other way around. So it's pulling more of the city towards the western part. There are small businesses and there are people on the eastern part of the city. There are huge industries on the eastern part of the city, no doubt in that. Sure. But they'll try to shift the locations and then try to shift the businesses towards the western part. And then start with Ashram Road and then they move forward to CG Road and everything. But when their expansion comes in place. The reason necessarily for the city to shift toward western part is maybe the connectivity to the Sanand, the infrastructure all over there.
Okay.
The town planning schemes that they've come up, the government has come up in the ring road sort of thing. Government has defined 1 kilometer from the ring road as a residential affordable housing zone.
Sure.
And that's why you see areas like Shilaj and Bhopal and everywhere pulling off very well. So yes, that's the answer.
So fantastic. So last question, I would like to, take suggestions from all the eminent, panelists here. If somebody is buying a property, okay, what are the key four, I'll give an option. You just have to give a one particular answer that if you want to buy a property, commercial property, let's talk about, because we've been talking about commercial. What are your first preference you would look at? One is price. Second is location. Third, if it is amenity and quality of construction. So if I have to ask that out of this four, which is the first preference, if you'll have to, buy the property, which of the preference you will look at? So, my part, if you can answer. So price, location, amenities, and quality of construction.
So if I talk about any Gujarati person who is going to buy the property, he will not miss any of this. But at the end of the discussion, he will say, "Kitla ma padse."
Achha, so price. Okay, great. So Prashant, what is your answer? Out of price, location, amenities, and quality of construction.
It's very similar to what Parth has answered, but for me, location would be a priority because because I wouldn't want to lose out on the businesses.
Okay, so second is a location. Rajesh bhai.
I would say aspiration. Aspiration for me could be living in the east, maybe living in the south, maybe, you know. So location is answered by the aspiration. The pricing, which could be right for you, could be wrong for me. So pricing also subjective. So all the package put together would be the right decision to make.
Okay, very diplomatic. Everything together is the answer. But still, you know, looking at this, I could make out, you know, the answer you are saying is more of a location with an amenities. Okay. Samirji?
Yeah, so for me, we've always had this motto that the top three reasons are location, location, location.
Fantastic.
Okay, so especially for commercial properties.
I got the answer. So three locations, one is price. Okay. Swagat?
Sir? Yes, location obviously. And
fantastic. No, really, really great. So I am just looking for a one word answer only, because you know that's very, very critical when generally we interact with the, you know, investor or client or an occupier, and we always say that, you know, you pay high prices, that is fine, but don't compromise in location. Obviously, you know, people nowadays, out of the RERA, the developer are so very clear, transparent, quality is not being compromised or so. Thank you so very much. With this note, Sapna, I would like to end this session, and I would like to thank you and all the panelists and the participants who have joined this session and, you know, given an opportunity to share our thoughts and views. Thank you,
Sapna. I think we got some really great takeaways from this entire discussion in terms of, you know, Gujarat has its own model of commercial developments and should not follow other cities, you know, like Samir and Mr. Rajesh mentioned and other panelists, and we had a good mix of views and opinions from the veterans of the industry as well as the young leaders of the Gujarat real estate. So thank you so much everyone for being here and sharing your time, your views and opinions. Thanks Viren for moderating this session, bringing the best out of our speakers here. Thanks Mr. Prashant Bhatu, Mr. Parth Patel, Swagat Vyas, Mr. Samir Sinha and Mr. Rajesh Vaswani for being here on this panel and sharing your opinions. Thank you so much.